The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve Him as His dear children, but we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to Him and plead for His mercy.
Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you, and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me, according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin, and take away my guilt.
God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all of your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus, He has removed your guilt forever. You are His own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to His will.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Oh,
Good morning. I was being shot. Sometimes on a Saturday morning, I listen to a quiz show called Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me. And there's something on that show that happens every week. They have three things, and three stories, and only one of the stories is true. I'm going to play that quiz with you. Okay? Got to guess which one is the true one. Pastor went fishing with his buddies last week, our annual fishing trip, and one of these three things happened. Number one, for the first time, we got skunked and didn't catch a single fish. Number two, for the very first time, we caught our limits, a fish. Or number three, Pastor Hoff fell in the lake, and it wasn't just pretend like a vacation Bible school and I poured a bucket of water in it. So which one of those three is true? The middle one. We caught our limit of fish. You are a good guesser. Right? Very good. The reason that I wanted to play this little game with you is to demonstrate something about the Christian faith. You know, when people say they're a Christian, you never know exactly what that means. Because people have all different ideas. Some people think that just means that you do a lot of good things. Some people think that that's just a name that was given to you on your baptism, and so that distinguishes you between the Buddhists and so forth. You're in that group. Some people think that Jesus was just a good guy who came and taught people how to love each other. And we teach that Jesus Christ was true God and true man, and he lived the only perfect life and came and gave that life to pay for the messed up lives that we have. So how do you know which it really is? How do you know? Will the real story come forth? Huh? How do you know for sure what the truth is about my fishing trip? I told you, right? I was there, so I should know. So that's how we know what the truth is about the Christian faith. We ask Jesus. We listen to his word. We listen to the Bible so that we know what the true faith is. Basically, the Christian faith can be summed up with the word joy. I bet you can't guess what the letter J stands for. You're right. That's Jesus. And Jesus is what it's all about. He's our Savior. He came to rescue us. And when we put him first in our lives, then everything is in the proper order. Now, the O stands for... How about others? Others come second in our life, right after Jesus. And before... You, yourself. No, normally we put you first, right? I want to be first in line. I want to be number one. We usually put ourselves first. But Jesus turns that all around. And anything that calls itself Christianity that doesn't really talk about joy, Jesus first and others second and yourself third, really is fake. It's not the real thing. It's not authentic Christianity. But when we put Jesus first as our Savior, and others second, and then finally ourselves, then we've got everything in its proper place. And that is true Christianity. May that joy be yours. Thanks for coming up. Anyone who is not familiar with the parable of the Good Samaritan has missed a lot of church. That's perhaps one of the best known of all of Jesus' parables. A man by the name of Clovis Chapel
preached a sermon on it in which he kind of outlined the basic story of the parable in this way. He said that the attitude of the thieves represents the attitude of life. What is yours is mine, and I will take it if I possibly can. The attitude of the priest and the Levite, the next that we run into in the story, summarizes the attitude of life. What is mine, and I will keep it for myself. And finally, there is the Christ-like attitude of the Good Samaritan. What is mine is yours, and I'd be happy to share it with you if you have the need. Of course, all three of those attitudes, if we're all honest, we will admit, can be found in every one of our hearts. And our goal as Christians, Clover Shackle said, was to make the God-like, the Christ-like attitude of the Good Samaritan to be chief in our hearts and lives. Please arise for the reading of the Holy Gospel from Luke chapter 10. Begin reading at verse 25. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Well, what is it written in the law? He replied, how do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. You would think that everyone would recognize the total and complete wrongness of that attitude of the thief. What is yours is mine, and I will take it however and whenever I can get my hands on it. But unfortunately, the world has always had thieves. And it seems that we are completely losing our moral grounding these days. Thieves abound, and sometimes in high places, in government and industry, people who line their own pockets and bring disaster upon countless other people at their own expense. And then we have this constant barrage of scammers trying with every imaginable trick to somehow work their way into your pocketbook. Identity thieves who sneak in and empty your bank account. And yes, there have always been those in government, ungodly governments who have taken the honest working man's wages with unjust taxation. There have always been thieves that worthless attitude, what is yours is mine and I'll take it if I please. And if we're all honest, we all know that there's a bit of that thief in every one of our hearts. None exempted. A lot more understandable and more easily justified is the philosophy of the priest and the Levite. What is mine is mine, and I will keep it for myself. Isn't that the way everyone thinks? Look out for old number one. Take care of yourself first. Those two fellows in Jesus' parable probably even had good religious excuses for their way of thinking. Perhaps one had just finished a stint of duty in Jerusalem and was coming home. He'd been away from home for a long time. Maybe he missed his son's birthday party. People were waiting for him. No time to dawdle. Maybe another one was on his way to Jerusalem to fulfill his duty to the Lord God Jehovah. And he wouldn't be able to do that if he had blood on his hands. God comes first, you know. Likely very good excuses for that attitude. The priest and the Levite, we are they. Rare is the Samaritan. How clever of Jesus to use the hated Samaritan as the hero of his story. In the Good Samaritan, the heart of Jesus is exposed. Hated by his fellow man, and yet willing to give his everything for the very ones who hated him. And once asked the question, what's it going to cost me? Would he help me if I were the one in the ditch? Will he repay me? Is he worthy of my effort? No such questions. Only completely unreserved care and concern for a person who had a need. Lord, help us to see the unspoken truth of this parable. Namely, that we are the man in the ditch. We usually compare ourselves to the priest or the Levite, maybe the thief, Good Samaritan, of course. We are the man in the ditch, Lord, and you are that Good Samaritan. Help us to see with your eyes the needs of our fellow man as you have seen our needs. Help us to think with your mind, pure thoughts. Help us with your heart to have a heart of compassion. Help our hands and feet to move in harmony with your hands and feet as we reach out to help one another. We join to sing hymn 390, Salvation Unto Us Has Come.
There's something missing. Some take the parable of the Good Samaritan to be the be-all and end-all of Christianity. If we do not see Jesus in that parable, if we hear only his final words, "Go and do likewise," we likely, like some have, would come to the conclusion that being a Christian simply means being a do-gooder. No doubt the something missing has to do with the context of the parable, the situation in its mouth. Jesus was not dealing with an honest inquirer like Nicodemus, with whom he could be very forthright and open. "Unless you're born again of water and the Spirit, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven." Now, this was a man who stood up to test Jesus. Luke tells us that his one entire passion was to justify himself. You can be sure that Jesus did not tell this parable to help him justify himself, to show him how to do it. Rather, Jesus told this parable to make it very clear to him and to all that we have not justified ourselves. Our Old Testament lesson, I think, will be helpful in taking us to that something missing in the parable of the Good Samaritan. Our Old Testament lesson is from Moses' farewell sermon. As he looks back and recounts all the laws that God gave on Mount Sinai 40 years before. Listen carefully. From Deuteronomy chapter 24, we begin reading at verse 17. "Do not deprive the alien or the fatherless of justice, or take the cloak of a widow in pledge. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and that the Lord your God redeemed you from there. That is why I command you to do this. When you are harvesting in your field and you overlook a sheaf, do not go back to get it. Leave it for the alien, the fatherless, and the widow, so that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. When you beat the olives from your trees, do not go over the branches a second time. Leave what remains for the alien, the fatherless, and the widow. When you harvest the grapes in your vineyard, do not go over the vines again. Leave what remains for the alien, the fatherless, and the widow. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt. That is why I command you to do this." This is the word of the Lord. So here is the Old Testament version of the parable of the Good Samaritan told in plain old Mount Sinai command fashion. Just do it. This is what you are to do. The first thing that may jump out at us is the repetition four times in these few short verses of the alien, the fatherless, and the widow. The alien, the fatherless, and the widow. Here are the downtrodden. Here are those who have no one to stand up for them. Here are those that are going to have a difficult time of supporting themselves. Whether you agree with Trump's immigration policy or with Bernie's socialist agenda or not, as Christians, we know very well that God wants us to have a heart for the downtrodden and to be willing to do something, to sacrifice something for those who have need. The second thing that we might kind of jump out at us in these verses is it's basically the same thing three times, whether it's the grain harvest or whether it's the olive harvest or whether it's the grape harvest, it doesn't matter. The point is, don't let your bottom line, your pocketbook, determine everything. You are to have a care for those who have need. This was basically God's Old Testament welfare program. Some people don't like welfare programs. God had one. There needs to be one for people who have need. Paul's words in Ephesians chapter 4 came to my mind as I contemplated this. There the Apostle Paul says, he who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands. And you would think it would go on to say, so that he can have his own stuff and not be taken to somebody else's. But instead, he has a surprise ending. He should be doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. The Christian works extra hard, not so that he can have the latest luxury, but so that he can have something to share with those who are in desperate need. Finally, did you catch the truth of something missing from the parable of the Good Samaritan? It's here. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt. That is why I command you to do this. God does not ask us to play the part of the Good Samaritan so that we can redeem and justify ourselves before God, so that we can make points with the Almighty, so that we can work our way into His graces. God asks us to play the part of the Good Samaritan because we once were the man in the ditch. He asks us to play the part of the Good Samaritan because the Good Samaritan has rescued us. Any help that we give for another is nothing more than a thank you, compelled and moved by the love that Christ has had for us, or else it's not worth doing. That was true in the Old Testament. It is equally true today. We join to sing hymn 505, Love is the Generous Gift.
Thank you.
Christianity really look like? No parables, no beating around the bush, just plain out, what does it look like? In our final lesson, the Apostle Paul has a whole grocery list, a checklist, if you will, things that we certainly will be looking to God for, that we might live the authentic Christian life. Our Old Testament lesson is, our epistle lesson is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 12, beginning at verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord. Love, Paul begins with. That's what it's all about. We heard it in our first lesson. Love is the summary of all that God expects of his people. It's what we have failed to give. It made it necessary for Jesus to come and save us. Love is also the chief fruit of a justifying faith. That which is pictured on our bulletin cover for today. It will be present in those who have that saving faith. And Paul begins by saying love must be sincere. Literally, not hypocritical. No play acting, no going through the motions, no showing off, the real stuff. And it almost immediately, he points out the difference between real love and this fluffy stuff that people so often call love. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Real love has hatred. Ironic, isn't it? Abhor, despise that which is evil. Literally, be glued to what is good. True love judges. Mark that very carefully. True love judges what is right and what is wrong, the good and the evil, and knows the difference, and abhors what is evil. Clings to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Live in harmony with one another. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Real Christianity is focused on others. On others. And it can be. Because we don't have to work our way to heaven. Jesus did that for us. He rescued us. And he has given us a whole family of believers to watch out for us. Our hands are free to be able to serve one another. And all this brotherly love is possible because of the very nature of authentic love. Honor one another above yourselves. Do not be proud, Be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. This selfless nature of love is possible because we don't have to look out for ourselves. Jesus looks out for us. We can have that kind of love that he was describing, that true Christian fellowship. And he noticed that he said hospitality. Hospitality literally means love of strangers. And he says, pursue that like a hunter would pursue his prey. This is something we want to be really good at. Be really good at love of strangers, so that every alien stranger in our midst might feel perfectly at home. It's because we're focused on others. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. What an enormous amount of good has been left undone because of procrastination. Huh? Well, I'll get around to it eventually, maybe tomorrow. And that terrible waste can be avoided when we do all that we do to the glory of God. When it's the love of Christ that compels us, that can build up a big enough head of steam that we can make it over those hard things, difficult things to do that often cause us to say, well, I'll put it off until later. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. It's natural to want to avoid the hatred of the world. And many Christians and churches today are compromising their doctrine and their practice so that they can avoid that persecution. They can avoid the disapproval of those around them. Compromise is not an option. It's not one of those things that, as he says, as far as it is possible for you, live at peace with everyone. That's not one thing that's possible. Matthew Henry, an old English commentator, has this remark to say about this. Peace without purity is peace in the devil's palace. It's a slap in the face of the Lord to compromise his word, his truth, or his way of living, morality, with the world. That is simply not an option for the Christian. Rather, Paul says, remain under tribulation. Just go ahead, take it. Hang in there. And you can do that because of what he has surrounded that phrase with. You remain under tribulation. Be patient under tribulation. How? Because you have that joyful hope, that eternal hope, and because you have faithful prayer. You've got the tool, the direct line to God himself. You can handle it. The true test of authentic Christianity. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The Christian way is not the way of anger and retribution, payback. It is the way of love and forgiveness. Jesus himself demonstrated that as he hung on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Many are the stories that could be told. Amazing stories of Christians following in Jesus' steps. I'll tell you one. Richard Wurmbrand was a man who was in Soviet prisons for 14 years back in the heyday of communism because of his Christian faith. And at one point in his imprisonment, a guard who had been particularly mean to the prisoners got thrown into prison with him. And when they asked him why he was in prison with them, he told them this story. He said one day a little 12-year-old boy came to him with a fistful of flowers. And he said, "Today is my mother's birthday. I always give my mother flowers on her birthday. But I don't have a mother anymore because you killed her. And I know that my mother wants me to love my enemies. And so, comrade, would you please take these flowers and give them to your wife?" This hardened man collapsed, buckled. He could not persecute another Christian, became one of them, and got thrown into prison with them. The Christian, instead of asking, "How can I repay someone for wronging me?" asks, "What good thing could I possibly do to make that enemy into a friend?" When Jesus, the real Jesus of the Gospels, gets his proper place, the Lord of the universe, the Lord of nations, the Lord of our hearts, the Lord of our lives, are number one. And others get put second, only ourselves third. Then our lives, disjointed by sin, get put back into its proper order. That is joy, and that is authentic Christianity. Amen. Please rise. In the confession of our Christian faith, using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Congregation may be seated. As we receive our faith offering, we will join in the singing of our next hymn, the Blue Worship Supplement, in unity and peace. Our God, by your Spirit, teach us carefully and deliberately to weigh in our hearts the matter of Christian giving, that our gifts might always reflect that great debt of love that we owe you. Help our offerings and gift be such that are pleasing to you. For Jesus' sake we ask it. Amen. Our prayers today are responsive prayers. We join to pray. We lift up our souls to you, O Lord, in whom we trust.
Mindful of your mercy and your steadfast truth, accept our adoration and praise.
Surrounded by humanity's injustice, cruelty, and untruthfulness, it is refreshing to know and believe that you are the source of all truth and mercy.
We thank you for the truth revealed in your word, that our salvation is in Jesus Christ, your Son.
We thank you for your undeserved love, which prompted you to send us salvation through the person of your Son, Jesus Christ.
As recipients of your gracious love, we regret that we have failed to show you adequate thanks.
We have not loved you with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind.
As a result, we have also not loved our neighbor as ourselves.
Aware of those who need our help, we, like the priest and the Levite, have often passed by on the other side.
Not only have we neglected to meet our neighbor's physical needs, but we have also failed to supply his spiritual needs.
For our lack of zeal in sharing our earthly gifts and the gift of salvation, forgive us, O Lord.
Help us to be strengthened with all power, according to your glorious might, that we may bear fruit in every good work and increase in divine knowledge.
Give us that endurance which reveals itself in patience and joy, as we work for the expansion of your kingdom.
We pray for those who are in physical or spiritual need.
This weekend of this national holiday, we bring our nation to you in prayer, asking that in spite of our many failings, that you would use our nation in your great plan for our world.
In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. That we will be constantly bringing our nation to our Lord.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
There just may be a couple things I'll draw your attention to. The past, I don't know how many summers, there have been organ concerts at Trinity in Watertown over the noon hour on Wednesdays. I got to take in a few of those. It was a wonderful way to spend your lunch hour. But they're not doing that this year, and I don't know if that's why St. Paul's and Gwinnett decided to step in, but they're kind of doing the same thing. So notice the first concert will be for the month in Fort Atkinson. And it's not just organ disciples, there's other things that are going to be happening also. You can get down that way over your lunch hour. It's a wonderful way to spend your lunch hour. And in that regard, also announcements. Mickey Milbrath asked us to announce that the choir is in desperate need of an accompanist. Contact her if you have a suggestion, some help. And of course, the next couple weeks are going to be very important and full weeks for us. Have a blessed week in the Lord. Happy Fourth.